Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1. Continue our series in this book. Next week we'll obviously take a week off. We're hitting a pivotal verse this morning. And actually, what we just prayed about, which has some real relevance to this verse as well. Now, part of getting in this, yesterday's always 3 weeks I'm preparing. Saturday's a big preparation day for me. But yesterday, my message preparation was interrupted because we were going to be taking our daughter, granddaughter Sophie, out for her 6th birthday. So what we do is we, on the birthdays of our grandchildren, they get a special day with Nemo. So Kim does things with them throughout the day, and then Pop-Up takes them, and Nemo, we take them out to the Pop Shop in Medford. And usually we see someone from the church there. We go to the Pop Shop, and we enjoy the food there, get ice cream and those kinds of things at the Pop Shop. Now, I've always known that my grandsons, they love superheroes. And no doubt the reason they love their superheroes is because their dads love superheroes. In fact, it's alarming how much their dads know about superheroes. And sometimes you feel like the lines of reality aren't blurred, that there really aren't superheroes. But their dads love superheroes, and they've instilled the superhero thing into their boys. What I didn't know until yesterday is that I have one granddaughter, my other granddaughters, I knew more about princesses, but I have one granddaughter who also loves superheroes. And so she, her and Kim picked me up yesterday at the office to go to the Pop Shop for lunch, and she came in, and she wanted to pick me up. It was not me, Mom's going to go get you. It was, I want to get Papa in his secret back door. Like, I have a secret back door, but it's superhero thing, so everything's secret. The secret back door in my office, the back cave, the preaching cave. and I want to get Papa. So she showed up, and she is fully regaled as Batgirl. I mean, she's got boots and things and, you know, bat ears. I mean, that's she who she was. And so we take her, I'm like, oh, you look amazing. And she's just all into Batgirl. She goes, but I can't be Wonder Woman. Why is that? Well, she dresses immodestly. Instructional modesty. You know, and she shows her tongue. And she goes, but actually, if I wore a t-shirt underneath the costume there, I could be Wonder Woman. But she was all into Batgirl. I was thinking back on this, and I said, I can't wait to take her out for her 16th birthday and show her pictures from her 6th birthday. And she's gonna be like, and she took the whole day. I mean, they went to Walmart, she's that girl. You know, everywhere they went, she was fully regaled as a superhero. And when I think about it, what's our fascination with superheroes? Well, it's the stuff they do, right? And you know, how many times you get that icebreaker question, what superpower would you like to have? Right? We love superpowers, superheroes, because they can do cool stuff. They usually show great courage against great odds. It's always like they're not going to win, not going to make it, and then pull things out. And they make a huge difference. They show courage. They make a difference. They overcome odds. And so we celebrate superheroes. Sometimes, I think that can drift into our Christian thinking. And here's how. It's only that superheroes would make the difference, right? The idea of Paul. Yeah, well, of course Paul can say that to live as Christ and die as gain. He's Paul. And maybe it's Peter who's also going to die a violent death. And well, that's Peter or Martin Luther. Martin Luther was able to stand there. Except, here, by the grace of God, I stand. And he nails the 95 theses to the Wittenberg door and said, yeah, Luther, I mean, they wanted to kill Luther. Well, of course, that's Martin Luther. Perhaps it's Charles Spurgeon. And what he did is he was the most read man in all England and his materials. Or Billy Graham or John Piper. And we can sometimes have this superhero mentality around Christians. And here's the concern I have. If we think making a difference is relegated to superheroes, that will weaken the claims of Scripture on us. See, if we drift into the people that matter are those heroic figures. I'm not one of the apostles. And folks, there are heroic figures. There's no doubt. And they're unique. We're just not called to compare ourselves to them. And I think we think, well, yeah, that's radical, that's powerful, well, that's for a different class. And it's really not that. Actually, Philippians is written just to a normal, sort of small, somewhat insignificant local church. So we don't want to have the claims of Scripture weakened on us, nor do we want the promises of Scripture weakened as well. Because God's word was written to us and for us. So what we're going to be talking about this morning is addressed to us. Average, normal, ordinary, everyday people. It's not written to the elite, to the spiritual superheroes. I've entitled this morning's message, Everyday Courage for Everyday People. Everyday Courage for Everyday People. The main point is this: God calls each of us to stand steadfast and stand together for the gospel. God calls each of us to stand steadfast and stand together for the gospel. So, Philippians chapter 1, beginning of verse 27. Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of you, that you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel, and not frightened in anything by your opponents. This is a clear sign to them of their destruction, but of your salvation, and that from God. For it has been granted to you that for the sake of Christ, you should not only believe in him, but also suffer for his sake. Engaged in the same conflict that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. Let's pray again and ask for God's blessing. Lord, what a timely word this morning, light of what just heard take place in Egypt, which can be frightening to the churches in Egypt and the Middle East, other places where persecution rages against Christians. Lord, here we have something very clear that calls us not to be frightened. It doesn't guarantee that we will not run into persecution. It's because of persecution, Lord, that we need to have our faith strengthened. But God, these were real words to real world people who have a real empire, a real political force opposing them and threatening their lives. So God, this is written now for us, to us and for us, to help us and to strengthen us, so that we would stand firm, stand side by side, and contend for the gospel, and not be frightened. So Lord, help us to do that, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Paul starts Philippians in his writing. He starts very relationally, if you've noticed. He's very encouraging to them, so he's talking about this church and the partnership that they've shared, and so there's this encouragement and love that he's expressing towards them. And then he sort of gives them a personal update. He tells them about his life. You know, this is what's going on in my life. And he's trying to bring perspective to bear. Like, I know I'm in jail. I know that concerns all of you. But this is what's happened. My being in jail has actually encouraged the gospel to go forth. So it's going forth into the Roman guard, this elite guard in the Praetorium, in the Roman Caesar's own household. And it's emboldened other Christians to preach the gospel. So the gospel's going forth. So he's sort of giving them encouragement and a personal update. But in verse 27, this is a hinge point. Things change. They take a turn. Because in verse 27, Paul gives his first major exhortation. And this exhortation is central to the whole letter of Philippians. So 1:27 is central to the message and theme of Philippians. And it says this: live your life, right? Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ. Now remember, Paul's writing, he is writing to church leaders, but not exclusively to church leaders. It's not just church leaders or Christian superheroes. This is not an exhortation for John Piper, Billy Graham, R.C. Sproul, Martin Luther. This is an exhortation to all of us. It's to everyday people, people like you and me. So how does this text tell us to live a life worthy of the gospel? Three things that we're going to look at this morning. First, living worthy of the gospel requires contemplation of the gospel. Okay, living worthy of the gospel requires contemplation or meditation, thoughtful consideration of the gospel. And we'll see this in, think in verse 27, only let your manner of life, and he's not explaining the gospel a lot. There's assumption he has. This is a church that understands the gospel, has embraced the gospel. He's exhorting them now to contemplate the gospel. Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ. What is the gospel of Christ? See, right away, he's getting them to remember and think about something. The gospel of Christ is his death, resurrection, and ascension. You know, that's what he's talking about. It's the whole story of Christ. So both birth, life, death, crucifixion, resurrection, the death and resurrection being central to the whole thing. So he's trying to pull them into, do you remember this gospel? It's the gospel of Christ. When I came and preached this gospel, I explained to you how Christ came and lived for you, how he died for you, how he was raised for you, how he was ascended. I'm telling you my experience with this gospel. So he's drawing their attention to the gospel of Christ. And then in verse 28, he says something else. And halfway through 28 says, this is a clear sign to them of their destruction, but of your salvation, and that from God. Salvation is from God. So we think thoughtfully, right? Consider, contemplate what's he saying here. Well, he's saying this, it's God's initiative to save us. And I can only think as this letter is being read of the audience. This gospel, God's initiative, the story of Christ, was given to save us. And I think of Lydia being in the robes and just saying, yeah, I remember. I'm just a businesswoman. I was a God-fearer. And I worked at some point, but that's all. And then Paul arrived in our city and he preached, and my heart was opened to the gospel. And you think about the slave girl who had, you know, the ability to predict the future. So yeah, I was tormented by demons, and yet the gospel came and set me free. Or the Roman jailer, and probably his family, as this revelation read to them, and they're like looking down the road and saying, do you remember? Do you remember that night? When we were in the jail, Dad thought that was the last time he was going to be alive. I thought the prisoners were gone, and I was going to kill myself. You would have been fatherless. And now, look, because me and my household, we're here in church. Because God takes initiative to save. So we have this gospel of Christ. Salvation comes from God. It's his initiative to save. And then in verse 29, he still, I thought, for it has been granted to you that for the sake of Christ, you should not only believe. So what we have here, the emphasis is going to be on the second part, suffer. But the first part is believe. They've been granted to believe. Folks, it's a gift to even believe. Our believing does not come from our goodness, nor our intelligence, nor our inclination towards God. Scripture is very clear. There's no one that seeks after God. No, not one. So what happens here? The Holy Spirit is at work, drawing people, removing blinders from their eyes so they can see the beauty of Christ through the gospel of Christ. Timothy Keller, in his book, Reason for God, says the following. The Christian gospel is that I am so flawed that Jesus had to die for me.
Amen.
Yet, I am so loved and valued that Jesus was glad to die for me.
Mm-hmm.
You need both. This leads to deep humility and deep confidence at the same time. It undermines both swaggering and snooping.
Amen.
That's what the gospel does. It tells me something. It tells me something about myself. Oh my, worse than I thought. Someone had to die for me. But it also says, and someone loved me enough to do that.
Amen.
Yeah. God, nobody forced God's hand. Nobody guilted God into sending his son. He did this for the joy, just for the joy set before him. He endures the cross. So folks, to live worthy of the gospel, if we rush past the gospel itself, we'll live legalistically in response to the gospel. We'll live out obligations. So we first must contemplate the gospel. It's what we're thinking about this week. It's what we're thinking about Christmas. God left heaven. He came to earth. He lived a perfect life. He died for me. He was raised. It's an empty tomb. And that's the gospel. And how did I come to hear this gospel? How did I come to believe this gospel? Well, God's initiative came to me. And then God opened my eyes. Contemplate the gospel. Contemplate the gospel is central and crucial to living worthy of the gospel. Second, living worthy of the gospel calls for steadfast unity. Living worthy of the gospel calls for steadfast unity. Look again at verse 27. So only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ. Okay, now that's the exhortation. It's a hinge point in the book. It's an important verse to the book, to the letter. Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel. What's that going to look like? So he goes, so whether I come and see you, or I may hear you, here it is, that you're standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel. These are the words, stand firm, strive, side by side. Now, these words and this manner is all that your manner of life is, like your manner of life, another transition you have, live as citizens of the kingdom of God. And Philippians 3:20 talks about our citizenship being in heaven. So he's doing something here. Philippi, if you don't know the background a little bit, Philippi was a military town. Okay? A lot of people in the military and a lot of people retired from the military. That's what the town was. So there's battles that take place close by. Rome settles soldiers there. Retired men get property there. And so this is a military town. And if they're hearing this exhortation in their local church, I think what's coming back to them is that idea. Do you remember striving side by side when we were in the ranks, when we were in the battles? Remember how we stood firm side by side? See, this is actually full of military and athletic imagery. And you think about soldiers, what do you think about? It's the dedication. Right, and the camaraderie that they share. You know, I can't help it when I hear these things. You know, just Mel Gibson rings in my mind. Hold the line, hold the line. You know, hold fast, hold the line. Just was watching some excerpts of the film Gettysburg. And they're always like, we've got to break the line. We've got to break the line. Longstreet, he's debating whether they should do the Pickens charge, and he's sort of trying to work himself up and cheer himself into the charge across the field. He goes, maybe it'll break, because they say the line will break in the center, the line will break. Maybe it'll break, and we'll rout the human troops, and this will be a day closer to the end of this war. And Longstreet goes, but it's Hancock up there, and his boys won't break. They're going to hold the line. Well, Roman soldiers, you know, as they would be marching, they'd have their shields this way, and shields over on top of them, and they'd be marching with spears out, and it was hold the line, move forward. Strive. Think of the dedication, camaraderie. I don't know if you've ever seen the miniseries Band of Brothers. Great series. It's a great series. Band of Brothers captures this. It was about Easy Company, the 101st Airborne, and they were like a legendary company. Just made up of normal guys. I mean, they'll interview guys. You know, I was in Texas. I was a farmer. You know, one guy, I was from Philadelphia. You know, and that's just all they did. They just were normal guys. You know, when you see them being interviewed, you're not thinking heroes. You're not thinking Patton, Eisenhower. You're not thinking these generals. These are just the guys. But if they're in Band of Brothers, as they're trained to be in the airborne, and they're doing life together. And they had run this one hill. It was like, they had to run the hill. They just ran over and over again. And their drool started going, like, just resign. Just, you know, stop, quit. No, they became a band of brothers. They parachute in. They're at the front lines of the Battle of the Bulls. They're the ones who take over the Eagle's Nest, Hitler's lair, and they're just doing all these things, and people are dying left and right. High casualties in Easy Company. But they linked arms. And there was something like, you know, and they talk about it, like, there's something you experience in that you don't experience anywhere else in life. Where you have linked arms, you're gonna hold the line. Because if one runs, the whole line's affected. And they have this great camaraderie, this great commitment. They stand firm and stand together. Well, folks, that's what the church is being instructed to do right here. This isn't written to others, it's written to a church, small church, vulnerable church, church under persecution, church that's not accepted as legitimate, no place to meet, church. But they stand firm, and they stand together. So it's unity within, and friends, please understand this, it's unity within a specific local church. We are called to have unity in the body of Christ, which I agree with, support, but there is a specific call to a local church to have a specific unity. So Sovereign Grace of Marlton, stand firm. Sovereign Grace of Marlton, stand together. I wonder if this will be read sometime over in Egypt. I don't make light of what they've experienced. But I know one of the exhortations eventually would be like, stand firm. Stand together. It's probably not the first time they feared bombing. It probably won't be the last time. I wonder how Revelation strengthens them right now. There's more martyrs added to the appointed number of martyrs. There's an appointed number of martyrs, not just an appointed number of the elect, of those that God's going to save, but an appointed number of those that God's that are going to die for Christ. Can we even imagine ourselves in that? For me, that's hard as an American. It's hard to imagine. Here, I could die for my faith. I could be killed because I'm a Christian. It's hard for me to get my mind. And again, because of trips that I've had to India, where I've met people who've been beaten for the gospel and know people killed for the gospel, you know, but even there, it's like, when I'm there, I never feel danger. And what would it be like to think, yeah, I may go home to be beaten. My family could be attacked. It's risky to come together for church. And India is getting more risky. It's getting more radicalized to Hinduism. We're trying to convert people to Christianity is going to be an offense, a crime. Alice would strengthen them. Strive together, side by side, stand firm together. And this word strive, the Greek word for this word is son of athleo, which is where you get athleo. Think about athleo, athlete. That's where we get our word athlete from. So when he says strive in verse 27, strive, it's an athletic phrase for them, and they would have picked that up as well. They would have picked up the military intonations. They would have picked up the athletic intonations here. John Piper says the following about this. Not striving to spread the faith of the gospel is to treat the gospel as cheap. If the gospel is a vision of the glory of Christ without which no one can be saved, it is the most precious thing anyone can know. Good quote, do we believe it? To live worthily of the gospel, we simply must become, as it were, athletes. Men athletes and women athletes, 80-year-old athletes and 8-year-old athletes. That's what we need. That's what this church needs. So younger people here, we need you to be an athlete. We need you to stand firm and stand together for the cause of the gospel. Now, citizens in Philippi were proud of their citizenship. The Americans generally are proud to be Americans, right? You know, those songs, proud to be an American, live in the USA, you know, Bruce Springsteen, you know, the stadiums rock when he does that. And there's fireworks going off. Because we have a much greater citizenship, a much greater king, and a much greater message than freedom. Much greater. Your citizenship is in heaven. Philippians 3:20 makes that clear. That's where you reside. You actually are a foreigner right now. You're an alien. And we have a greater king. Oh, this would have affected Philippi, because Nero's in power at this point, and Nero wants, I'm the only one who's king. And they're going to talk about Christ being king, Jesus being king. Oh, that, you talk about a politically unacceptable message. That was it. But they had a greater citizenship, a greater king, and a greater message. So stand firm, strive side by side for the faith of the gospel. We're going to come to, when we get to chapter 4, you're going to see Paul address division in this church. He's not addressing division globally. He's not doing that. He could do that. But he's addressing division within a local church between two women, who, by the way, he says they did the same kind of thing. They were striving side by side with him. They were the same kind of partners in the gospel, just two women. We don't know a lot about them. But they were those men and women athletes who were striving to preach the gospel. So folks, how do we do that? How do we live worthy of the gospels by steadfast unity? Well, we've got to work at it. You're going to do this in daily decisions, normal life, as everyday people. Dennis Johnson, in his commentary, as he's talking about this, he calls it selfless solidarity. Do we have selfless solidarity? You heard a word this morning about people pursuing their own dream, right? Their own ambitions. We need to have a selfless solidarity. Selfless solidarity. Living worthy of the gospel calls for steadfast unity. Sovereign Grace Church in Marlton. We want to be united. We need to be diligent. Be firm in this. There is something about staying firm in one spirit, one mind, side by side for the faith of the gospel. Do you see what unites us? It's the gospel that unites us. It's the cause of the gospel that unites us. It's not our preferences that unite us. It's not our likeness that unites us. Other than we're God's children. That unites us to strive now for the gospel. Last point. Lastly, living worthy of the gospel resolutely embraces the call to suffer. Living worthy of the gospel resolutely embraces the call to suffer. In verse 29, for it has been granted to you that for the sake of Christ, you should not only believe in him, here's the emphasis of the verse, but also suffer for his sake. And you notice up in verse 28, it says, don't be frightened by your opponents. You're going to have real opponents. Do not be frightened by them. But you should engage, resolutely embrace suffering for the sake of Christ. See, this church was facing real opposition. We will face, I believe, folks, we will face opposition. I believe it is inevitable. Unless we compromise with culture, or stay in the confines the culture gives us. Goes like, okay, you want to believe in God, Jesus, fine. Keep it in the church. So if we accept the confines the culture will build around us, keep it in the church. You know, it's your news. Just keep it to yourself. Don't tell anyone else. How dare you tell someone else? By the way, it's going to move to that. How dare you tell someone else they need to believe? That's abusive language. It's abusive. Now, how we respond when those things happen is important. We don't want to get shrill, right? We don't want to get all, oh, I can't believe this is happening to us. It's happening around the world. It's always happened throughout history. Folks, we will face opposition unless we compromise the gospel, unless we agree to be innocuous to our culture, just keep religion to ourselves, right? The things you can't talk about in a polite crowd, politics and religion. So yeah, if we buy into that, we won't talk about religion. We won't talk about Jesus. It's a private thing. Folks, it's not a private thing. It's good news. That needs to be heralded, to be proclaimed. We have a king who sent us as ambassadors into the world to proclaim his message. It's good news. This is what we're called to do. And it says, don't be frightened. I've not had time to contemplate really what happened in Egypt today. I've not read the reports, I heard the report of it. And I'm thinking, this is the text for you. What if it starts getting closer to home? An American church blown up by terrorists. What are we going to do? How are we going to act through that? Vengeance? Fear? How dare? I'm not saying there's not, the state doesn't bear the sword. The state should bear the sword. And you do want justice for evil actions. But for Christians, they think about that far more into the future. And oh my. Probably wouldn't be the first message I would preach to them. I would preach comforts. I would take them to Revelation and into heaven. And other things, but boy, somewhere, stand firm. Stand firm, side by side, for the faith of the gospel. Do not be frightened by your opponents, regardless of what they do. Folks, this is not for superheroes. This is for everyday people. It's everyday courage for everyday people. I don't remember any of the names of the pastors I met in India. As far as just meeting the crowd, people I was there with, I remember those names, but not the guys that just came up and said hello. They were just everyday people who had everyday courage. It was given by God Himself. Don't be frightened. And why? There's reasons here. So if you're in verse 28, how we process Egypt, how we process, if this eventually hits the United States, how we process these things. Don't be frightened by anything by your opponents. And look what it says next. This is a clear sign to them of their destruction, but of your salvation and that from God. Do you know what happened in Egypt today? Is a clear sign of destruction to those who did it. God will not be mocked. He's the judge of all the earth. And he is going to avenge the blood of his martyrs. You can't get away from Revelation without feeling the impending judgment of God. Which, by the way, is a comfort to believers. Prevent them from revenge, fear. Serve them. See, why are we not fearful? There are eschatological realities. Okay, what the heck was that word? It's just what happens at the end. What happens at the end? At the end of the story is the most important part of the story. What happens? What happens at the end? He goes, you know what happens to your opponents? When they oppose the gospel, it's a sign of their destruction. And because they're opposing the gospel in you, it's a sign of your salvation. So he's trying to bring them into an end times reality. And for that, they don't have to be afraid. They can embrace this call to suffer. And by the way, it's suffering for the sake of Christ. So are we willing to embrace our call to suffer? I still think the storm clouds are gathering. Perhaps they'll recede, but they're there, folks, and they are gathering. And they're gathering in this nation. This is what Jesus says in Matthew 5, verses 11 and 12. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and of all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. And verse 12, rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. Do you see? We don't just resolutely embrace suffering. There's actually rejoicing in this. And this is all over the New Testament. Acts 5, 41 and 42. This is after the disciples are arrested for preaching the gospel. And they're in the presence of the council, which can kill them if they want. But they end up releasing because they have fear of the crowd. And it says this, then they left the presence of the council rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. Folks, this is a band of brothers. They're linking arms. I'm fighting for a cause. And when you hear the band of brothers, like, it would have been unconscionable not to be in the military during World War II. We linked arms. We were fighting a common enemy. We did it together. It was worth the cost. It was the right cause. How much more the gospel? So if we suffer, if one of our members gets shot out of line, we just relink. And we march forward. Because we believe the gates of hell will not prevail against the assault of God's kingdom. And so they left the presence of the council rejoicing they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. And every day in the temple and from house to house, they did not cease teaching and preaching Jesus as the Christ. So you know what they did? Oh, they were bold. They're going to stand side by side for the faith of the gospel. They're not frightened. Right? The leaders try to frighten them. First Peter 4. Peter writes the following, beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trouble when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. I think for us folks, this is our challenge. It's going to feel strange. Because it's not happening in America. Really. We get marginalized a bit and we get made fun of. But not this kind of persecution. Not this kind of like, you're all bigots. You're all this folk or that folk. You're all against somebody. You guys are all, that's what's coming. Certainly here to some degree. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fire trouble when it comes upon you, as though something strange will happen to you. But But rejoice insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory in God rests upon you. Sovereign Grace Church, may we stand firm in spite of opposition. May we stand together. Those men didn't stand together, band of brothers, because they all left one another right away. Because they had everything in common, but they were different. They saw something united them that was worth the cost, and they stood firm. That's what unites us. We stand firm. That's what grieved Paul's heart when he saw Lydia and Syntyche. They were partners. They were striving for the gospel with me. They're in the same building. They're in the same fellowship group. They're in the same church service. And now there is a division. And he pleads, no! Stand firm, but stand together. That's the unity that God calls us to. It's just an everyday call that needs everyday courage for everyday people like us. Let's pray. Lord, in light of the events of today in Egypt, this text for me took on more sobriety. Lord, I can be thinking, oh, where will I stand firm in the day of trouble, in the day of persecution? It's one thing to preach it now. What about then? God, I know this. You give grace for the day and the moment. If our day comes as a Christian church in America, you will give us grace to stand firm and to stand together. Lord, may we protect us. May we see how the gospel rallies us, claims us, has given us a different citizenship, a greater citizenship than that of being an American. May this be the cause that unites our heart, the cause that gives us courage, the cause that we will do, Lord, with all of our might to the very end. God, we're not comparing ourselves with the great saints of history. We're grateful for that. Lord, you just called us to do something, and we can all do something. We can all be faithful to what you put in front of us, so help us to do that, God. But we want to live a life worthy of the gospel. Worthy of Jesus Christ, who loved us enough to die for our sins. So may he get our greatest allegiance, our greatest commitments, and our greatest affection. In Jesus' name, amen.